of soul winning to show you what to do. I have trained literally tens of thousands of people in being personal soul winners. It is not something that all of a sudden you just think up and do. I believe it's something that you ought to practice. Soul winning is caught, stay with my thought, soul winning is caught more than it's taught. The way to be a good soul winner is to go and do it. Somebody says, well, I tell you what, I'm going to read a book about soul winning, and as I read the book about soul winning, the more I read, then the better I'll get. When I reach a certain level of understanding, then I will go. Well, you'll probably never go. You just need to go. You will learn more by making mistakes than you will by successfully doing. You'll learn how to knock on the door by knocking on it wrong. You'll learn how to say certain things by saying things wrong. And so, you go soul winning, and you practice it. You can't, somebody says, well, I tell you what if I do it wrong? What if I do it wrong? Then what happens? Well, there's not hell number two, or hell number three, or hell number four, or hell number five. No, there's only one place they'll go, and they were going there before you showed up. Hello? They were going there before you showed up. All right? And so, when you go soul winning, understand now that you might not know everything, but I don't know of a soul winner today that knows everything. I don't know one. I've never met a soul winner that was perfect. Not one time. And if you meet a soul winner that's perfect, it's probably because he's full of pride and he can't see his imperfections. All right? And so, you'll never be the perfect soul winner. You never will. You'll meet soul winners that do their best. And that's what God expects out of us. He expects us to do our best. Now, let me see. As Bill Lofton, you come again. I think I used somebody else yesterday. But pull up the chair right here, if you will. And you'll be the one that I knock at the door. And I'll only use you a little bit. You're preaching next, aren't you? Yeah, so you probably need to study your notes. Let me just use you just a little bit. And bring the chair. Yeah, you got to pick it up. All right, well, here's Lynn. All right, just have a seat. I tell you what, go away. Let me use somebody else, because you're preaching next. I feel unfair about that. There's a lot more to come, if you will. And, all right. And so, when you see somebody on the street, and you're out soul winning, do not be afraid to stop them and talk to them. Get it in your mind, that if they're human and they're breathing, they qualify. So if they're human and they're breathing. Now, if they're dead, they don't qualify. You know, they won't try to leave a dead person of Christ. It won't work. But now, if they're human and they're breathing, they qualify. So go up and talk to them. I do not carry a big Bible when I go out soul winning. If you carry a big Bible many times when you go out soul winning, what will happen is they will see the big Bible and they will run. They'll think that you're coming to study the entire Bible with them. And so they're afraid. And if they're in a house, they won't answer the door. And if they're on the street, they'll take off a running. And here's this poor 86-year-old woman that is running from you down the street because you had a big Bible. Okay? So I use, by the way, just as much power in the New Testament as there is in the Old Testament. Just as much power. And you can get somebody this. Just as much you can get somebody with this. Alright? So carry yourself a soul winning tool. I would get myself a New Testament. Just rehearse a couple things with you now. And I would highlight in that New Testament verses that you're going to use. Now you say, but preacher, I'm a soul winning seasonal person. I mean, I'm seasoned. I know my Bible, front and back. Wonderful. But you highlight the verses because on that page, you want their eyes to go up and down the page looking at every verse on the page. So you're highlighting the verse for two reasons. Number one, it'll help you. Number two, it will help them. If I was a new soul winner, I'd make a roadmap underneath the verses I'm going to use. I'd make a roadmap. I say always in 1 John chapter 5 and verse 13. And then I'll go over Romans chapter 3 and verse 10. Then I go to Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. Then I go to Romans chapter 3 and verse 23, and so on. And so I would make a roadmap underneath each verse for the next verse you're going to go to. That way, if you forget where you're supposed to go next, you have the reference written underneath the verse, and you can remember where you're going to go next. okay? In the back of my Bible, and I'll be discussing this with the pastors tomorrow and some of the handouts I give to the pastors tomorrow. But in the back of my Bible, I have, what I've done is I stopped at the book of Revelation. I don't blot out the Bible, but at the book of Revelation, I had all these helps back here. I had a Soldier's New Testament, had all these helps back here. Well, I don't need any of those helps. I know enough verses, I know enough Bible, that I don't need the helps. And so what I did is I took a piece of paper, I had my secretary to do it, I had a piece of paper that had an adhesive on the back of it, sticky on the back, and I had it to put those in my Bible for me. And so now I have about 20 pages back here, or 25 pages or so, that is just used for writing people's names that I lead to Christ. When I lead a person to Christ, here's what I do. I write their name, I write their address, I write their telephone number, I write their age, I write the day that they got saved, and then I will grade them. I will grade them. I'll write a P for poor, an F for fair, and a G for good. Now, how do I grade them? Okay, if I lead Donald to Christ, and Donald says, well, I tell you what, I've been going to church with my grandmother for 20 years. I'm glad I got saved today, but I'm not interested in coming to your church. Then I'll put a P there and I'll circle it for poor. I'm not going to go back and follow him up simply because of the fact he's already told me I'm not interested. If I lead Donald to Christ and he says, now, look, I'd be interested in visiting your church sometime. I don't think I can do it today, but I'll be interested in visiting your church sometime. Then I'll write an F there for fair, and I'll circle it. That means he may or may not come. If I lead him to Christ, and he says, well, I'll tell you what, Mike, I'd like to come to church this coming Sunday. It sounds like the type of church I love to come to, and I will come this coming Sunday. Well, I'll write a G there, and I'll circle it for good, for good. Now, what I do is, in my late afternoon on Saturday, is I will follow up those that have G's beside. Only the good. Only the good. I will make a list, and I will follow up those that are good prospects. Those that are poor, I don't follow up. Those that are fair, I may follow up if I have time. Those that are good, I follow them up firsthand. Now, if you're like I am, and by the way, if you're a good soul winner, you will lead hundreds and thousands of people to Christ. You will lead hundreds and maybe hundreds of thousands of people to Christ. So if you're a good soul winner, you're not going to run out of people. I'm leading people to Christ every week in the world. I lead people to Christ on the planes. I lead people to Christ in the elevators. I lead people to Christ in waiting rooms. I lead people to Christ on trains, in planes. I mean, I talk to people all the time, all right? And so I'm leading many, many people to Christ. Well, unless you grade them, you will not be able to follow them all up. So you've got to have some type of grading process to be able to follow them all up. So what I do with grading process is in the back of my New Testament. I'll write their name, I'll write their address, I'll write their telephone number, and I'll write good, a G, fair, the F, or P, the poor, and I'll grade them right there and there to be able to follow them up. Then what I do is I'll write their age. Then when I walk them down the aisle to be baptized, what I'll do is I'll write a B in red ink, and I'll circle it. That means I've already got them baptized. All right, I know my next step is this. I'm going to get them involved in our adult discipleship training on Sunday night. I'm going to enroll them in a Sunday school class on Sunday morning. All right, we have Sunday school teachers, and also an adult discipleship trainer has a person stationed at the baptismal room. When a person gets baptized at our church, then we immediately try to sign them up for adult discipleship training. We immediately try and sign them up for a Sunday school class. So it connects. One connects to the other. That connects to the other. That connects to the other. All right? And you don't lose them in between the cracks. All right? Now, for simplicity's sake, we're going to say that he's not a saved man. And so I go to knock on the door, and he'll come, and he'll answer the door, okay? And I'll have my big Bible. All right? Here we go. And I knock on the door. And he comes to answer the door, and he sees the big Bible. And he runs. You know, when you're going to scare them, They're going to think that you're Jehovah's Witness. And you're going to scare them. All right? Now, but you can have a New Testament. You can put that New Testament somewhere. Lady, you may have a purse. Sir, you may have a back pocket. And you can tuck that New Testament somewhere. All right? We'll head out, see. And so I come and I knock on the door. He comes to the door. He opens the door. I always use my first name. My name is Mike, and this is my partner, Sam, and we're out visiting from Parkside Baptist Church. We're in the area just visiting around, and we're going to come knock on your door and invite you to church. Do you go to church anywhere?
Yes, I'm Catholic.
You're Catholic. Okay, now look. When he says, yes, I'm Catholic, do not scold him. You do not say, what? You're Catholic. You never know a Catholic is going to die in heaven. Alright? He will slam the door in your face and tell his big dog to eat you. You don't do that. If he says, I'm Catholic, okay, start asking him questions. First off, him telling you that he was Catholic just told you the doctrine that he is affiliating himself with. So if he says, I'm Catholic, then you know automatically he believes in the work salvation. Is that right? Yes or no? That's right. All right, so he says, I'm Catholic. All right, I ask him some questions. How long have you been Catholic?
All my life.
All your life.
Since I was born.
Since you were born. Do you go to church all the time?
No.
No?
I don't have time.
You don't have time to go to church? Right. Now, what did that tell me? That told me that he's a Catholic that is a non-practicing Catholic, which probably means he does not know Catholic doctrine. So I'm asking him questions. All right? And let me ask you a question. I know you say you're Catholic and you don't go, all the time and stuff like that. Let me ask you, if I wanted to go to heaven and you were my friend, I wanted to go to heaven, what would you tell me to do?
Well, you need to be a good person.
Okay. Now, here's what I did. I said, if I was your friend, I put it on friendship basis. I'm not in his face. I'm not antagonizing him.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to push something down his throat. I've now become his friend. If I was your friend and I wanted to go to heaven, what would you tell me to do?
Well, I believe you need to be a good person.
Be a good person.
When you get to heaven, God will weigh all of that out.
Okay, so be a good person. Here's what I'm going to say. Okay, well, that's pretty neat. Is there anything else?
Well, I think you need to be good to people. I need to help to divorce or murder anybody.
Okay.
I said, pray too much.
He said, okay. He said, you need to be a good person. He said, you need to be good to people. Don't murder anybody and don't drink too much. Is there anything else?
No, I think that's about it.
Okay. You know, it sounds like you're interested in at least going to heaven. Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
Let me show you what the Bible says, okay? Now, what I do at that time in America, I say, I'm going to show you what the Bible says. Let me do this. It's hot outside, and we're going to stand outside. We're both going to get really hot. Let's do this. I'd like to come in. Let's step down for a few minutes, and let me show you what the Bible says. Okay? And I use it right then to get into a house. Okay? So I want to show you a couple of things, Donald, that you need to see about going to heaven. Oh, I tell you, it is hot out here. Let's do this. You mind? Is it okay? Right. We go into the house, and once we get into the house, I am the one. Let me out here. Okay? I'm the one that tells them where to sit. So we go into a house, and I see a sofa over there. I say, Donald, this looks like a good fit. I want us to sit down together. Why don't you sit right there?
Sure.
Okay?
Sure.
I'm going to sit right here. Now, I tell him where to sit in his own house. Okay? And I say, Donald, let me show you what the Bible says about going to heaven. Okay? And what I do is I start with 1 John chapter 5 and verse 13. When I'm showing him, I'm pointing to the verse. These things have I written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, that you may believe in the name of the Son of God. I'm looking at the verse. I'm pointing to the verse. Then what will happen when I make the point, I'm closing my Bible, and I say, now here's what that says. All right? And I'm guiding him. If you know, when you're talking to someone, you can guide them with your fingers. See, that's what the Bible says right there. Now, let me tell you what that means. Okay? And you guide them along. All right? Then let me show you what the Bible says you need to know. know it. I take them over to Romans chapter 3 and verse 10. As it is written, there's none righteous, no, not one. That means that none of us, we write those all the time. The Bible tells me where sin came from. Look right here. Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. Where it was by one man, sin coming into the world. And death by sin. So death passed upon it. All men, they all have sin. That's talking about Adam, the original sin. Have you ever heard about Adam and Eve in the garden? How Adam did sin by not obeying God?
Right.
That's what that's talking about.
He listened to his wife.
He listened to his wife. And you'll see right here that it talks about when he disobeyed God. When he disobeyed God, that brought sin into the world. Now watch this. Here's what the Bible says. The Bible says right here, Romans chapter 3 and verse 23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So because of sin, I come short of being able to go to heaven. Sin is the great barrier. I cannot go to heaven because of sin. Does that make sense to you?
Yes, it makes perfect sense.
Now, the Bible says that sin has to be paid for. Romans chapter 6 and verse 23 says, the wages of sin is death. So if I begin to pay the debt that I owe as a sinner, I'm going to have to die. Does that make sense?
Yes, that's what it says.
But it's not just a physical death. This is what the Bible says in Revelation chapter 20, verses 14 and 15. The Bible says in death and hell, which has been the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast in the lake of fire. So the Bible teaches if I die without Jesus Christ, because I've not been forgiven of my sin, I do not have eternal life. Eternal life is only in Jesus Christ. If I die without Jesus Christ as my Savior, I'm going to die and I'm going to go to hell forever. Do you understand that?
I do.
Would you want to spend all eternity in that place that's called hell?
Oh, no. No, I want to get forgiveness every day.
Yeah.
I pray a lot.
Yeah, you know the Bible says that you can have forgiveness. Romans chapter 5, verses 8 and 9, that God committed his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, the Bible says Christ died for us. Much more than being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath. That's that final judgment we just read about through him.
Right.
So only through Jesus Christ can we have forgiveness of sin. I cannot have forgiveness of sin because I've been baptized. A person can be baptized and still go to hell. I cannot have forgiveness of sin because I'm good. I cannot have forgiveness of sin because I go to church somewhere. I cannot have forgiveness of sin because I am a righteous person in my own eyes or in the eyes of my mother-in-law. I can only have forgiveness of sin through Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, the Bible says here, the Bible says he that hath the Son hath everlasting life. So everlasting life is in a person. That person is none other than Jesus Christ. So when I receive Jesus Christ as my Savior, Donald, I'm now able to go to heaven, because he washes away my sin, and he gives me eternal life. Does that make sense to you?
Yes, that makes sense.
The Bible tells me how to receive Christ. The Bible says here in the book of Romans, chapter 6, and verse 23, it says that wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ the Lord. So eternal life can be yours as a gift, but only through Jesus Christ. You see, Donald, Jesus Christ and eternal life is inseparable. You cannot separate one from the other. So when you receive Jesus Christ, you receive eternal life.
Yeah,
that makes sense to you?
That's good sense, yes.
Here's how the Bible says to receive Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10 and in verse 13, the Bible says, for whosoever, that's you, shall call upon the name of the Lord, shall be saved. The word calls in what we call the Greek punctilious tense. That means one time forevermore. So if I call you on the cell phone and you answer the cell phone, it is a complete connection. I don't have to call you again. The connection has been made complete. When I receive Jesus Christ as Savior, Jesus Christ makes a complete connection. I don't have to ask him over and over again. Book of John chapter 3 says you must be born again. It doesn't say you must be born again and again and again and again. It's not a perpetual state of being. It's receiving Jesus Christ one time forevermore. Do you understand that?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, and the Bible tells me how to do it. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Don't say might be saved. Don't say could be saved. Don't say possibly would be saved. Say shall be saved. Is that right?
That's what it says, yeah.
That's what it says. And so if a person simply understands four simple truths, Donald, they understand that they're a sinner. They were born that way, and they're a sinner. Do you believe that?
I do, yeah.
We understand that as a sinner that owed debt, Donald, the debt that you and I owe for our sin is death and hell. If we got what we rightfully deserved, we'd have to die and go to hell. You understand that?
Yes.
Donald, the Bible teaches that Jesus Christ paid the sin debt for us when he shed his blood on Calvary. And only through Jesus Christ can we have forgiveness of sin. We do not have forgiveness of sin in eternal life by being baptized, by being good, by going to church, by holding out faithful to the end, keeping one of the Ten Commandments or the seven sacraments. It's Christ and Christ alone. You understand that?
Yeah, I think so.
Do you also understand that a person needs to call upon Christ with their heart and ask Jesus Christ to be their Savior?
Yeah.
The Bible says, for with a heart man believeth unto righteousness. With a heart. So it's a heart decision. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir. I think so, yes.
Donald, today, would you like to ask Jesus Christ to be your Savior?
I think maybe that I should ask my wife about it.
Okay. It's good to ask your wife. But yet your wife, if you ask her, of course, she needs to make that personal decision. This is a decision between you and God. Would you not like to ask Jesus Christ to be your Savior today?
I guess I should.
Yeah. Okay. Then you can lead him in a prayer of asking Christ to be a Savior. Then go back over assurance verses. I use John chapter 3 and verse 18. I use John chapter 3 and verse 36. I'll take out a 3x5 card. Thank you. Be seated. I'll take out a 3x5 card, and on the 3x5 card, I'll draw a heart. I'll put his age inside of a heart. Then I'll draw a line underneath, leading from the bottom of that 3x5 card at the bottom of that heart, and I'll write the word light on the bottom of that line. So I have a heart with his age in it, a line with the word life written underneath. Then I'll write up here, heaven. I'll write down here, hell. And I tell them today is the day that we talked about Jesus Christ. I never tell him that he's saved. I let him tell me what he did. And I rehearse it with them to make sure he understood the simplicity of the gospel. I show them that what happened today was receiving Christ. And so above that heart, I'll draw a cross. I'll draw an arrow from that cross into that heart. And I'll write Jesus right there. So today you ask Jesus into your heart. Something changes now along that line. Because when you ask Jesus into your heart, your life changes. And I'll write the word eternal in front of life. God gave you eternal life. And then we'll go over those verses. Romans chapter 3 and verse 18. Romans chapter 3 and verse 36. And I give them what we call assurance of salvation. To be able to help them to see that once you receive Christ as your Savior, then of course that means that you'd be able to go to heaven. And I ask them questions. Then I get them committed to come on Sunday morning as my first goal. Donald, I want you to come Sunday morning. Be my guest. I want you to be my friend on Sunday morning. Come and sit beside me or sit beside one of my friends. We have a great church, a great family church, and we want you to come and to be a part of that. Would you come be my guest on Sunday morning, and I'll pick you up at 9:15. And he may say yes, he may say no. I tell you what, if you can't come at 9:15, he said no. I'll have a driver to come by and pick you up at 10:30. 10:30, a driver will be here, and they'll pick you up at 10:30, and you can come to the preaching service at 10:45. If he says, no, I don't want to do that, I say, okay, I want you to come tomorrow night at 6 o'clock. We have preaching service at 6 o'clock. I'll be by to pick you up at 5:30. And if he says, no, I can't come at all on Sunday, we have Bible study on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. Donald, I want you to come at 7 o'clock. I'll be by and pick you up at 6:30. He says, no, I can't come all this week. Next Sunday, we have church. We start it at 9:45, and I want you to come. I'll come by and pick you up at 9:15. I'm going to keep going until he tells me he's going to come. I'm going to keep going. And by the way, I'm going to go back and see him again. You know, he said, boy, I'm glad I got saved. I've been wanting to go to church for a long time. I'm glad I got saved. Wonderful. God bless you. And so, let me tell you how we're going to do this. And I try and help him. All right? But go over the plan of salvation. Ask questions. When you're dealing with a child, deal with a child on their level. You treat a child like you would want somebody to treat your child. You take time with them. Don't rush through it. Make sure they understand thoroughly their need of Jesus Christ. You take time with them. Then when you're treating an adult, you take time with that adult. You help that adult go thoroughly through the scriptures. Talk with them. Answer their questions. Ask them questions to make sure. Now, we have some men in our church, when they go soul winning, they'll take an hour to lead somebody to Christ. That's okay. We have other people go soul winning in our church, and they'll take 10 minutes. That's okay. That's all right. As long as they understand, you want to make sure they understand. You have to take the person where they are. Now, somebody says, well, I believe you get to heaven by works. We can show them Titus 3:5 or Romans 4:4-5 or Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, and many, many other verses to show them that works does not merit heaven. You can help them to see that. But don't always stay with me. Don't always stick with just a plan of salvation, and that is it, when you can help them. When you can help them. Learn verses. Commit verses to memory. Make those verses, if you will, a part of your presentation when you lead people to Christ. And deal with them. Take time and deal with them. You may have to use more verses on one person to help them to understand than you used on another person. But take time to deal with it. My friend Carl Hatch would always only use one verse every time I went soul winning with him. One verse. Romans chapter 10 and verse 13. That's all he would use. All right, wait a minute. Okay? Now, may I tell you that if that's what God is using him to do, and he gave his salvation testimony, and he was in your face, and he was talking to you, and, okay, now that's fine. And later on, he put out that soul winning card straight from the Bible. And use that soul winning card. All right, that's fine. But get yourself a plan. Get yourself a goal. Can I ask you a question? How many people did you talk to last week about Jesus Christ? I'm not talking about how many people got saved in your ministry. I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about how many people got saved in your class. I'm not talking about that. How many people have you personally led to Jesus Christ? How many people did you give a gospel tract to? How many people have you talked to personally about Jesus Christ? See, if you're not careful, here's what will happen. You will lose your personal zeal in showing people their need of Jesus Christ. Now, I beg you, please don't do that.
Amen.
You be that personal soul winner. You carry tracts with you everywhere you go. Everywhere you go. And you talk to people, and you give people tracts. I'd like to give you something to read, sir. Would you read that in your spare time? Would you do that? Now, that didn't hurt. I didn't bleed from that one. You know? Use the tract. Carl Hatch used to use the tract. I love to hear him soul win. He'd use the tract different ways. He'd say, I've got Easter's coming up. He'd say, I've got an Easter card for you. Easter card. Here's an Easter card. I'm not going to see you on Easter, sir. I'd like to give you an Easter card. That tells you how to go to heaven. That's an Easter card. Let me read you what it says right here. Do you mind? And he'd go and he'd, hey, sir, when's your birthday? When's your birthday? December the 22nd. You know, I'm not going to be around on your birthday. You know what I like to do? I like to give you a birthday card. Can I give you a birthday card? Matter of fact, this is a special birthday card because this birthday card tells you how to have two birthdays. How would you like to have two birthdays? Huh?
Yes, I like
that. You like that? I'm glad. And, okay, and so, and, all right, and, oh, hey, I'll tell you what, you've been married how long? 5 years. And we'll give you an anniversary card. Can I give you an anniversary card? Matter of fact, this is a card that will tell you how to have a happy anniversary every day of the year. Would you like to do that? Be happily married? Let me show you what the Bible says and how God can help you in your marriage. Would that be okay? All right. And so, but you can take and you can give tracts out all day long. All day long. My wife likes the smiley ones. You ever seen the smiley tracts? My wife passes out hundreds of those things. She orders them all by herself. And she likes the smiley tracks. And she'll go up to somebody and she'll say, sir, it looks like that you need a smile. So I'd like to give you a smiley track.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. You know, and she'll give out the smiley tracks. All right, now, what am I saying? I'm saying, if you're going to be a soul winner, you have to do it on purpose.
Right.
On purpose.
Yeah.
On purpose. You have to stop people on purpose. You have to be aggressive on purpose. You have to be excited about it on purpose. Now I'll tell you, listen, where I am, I'm done. So many I said is caught. More than it's taught. It's caught. I think I have a small part and the reason that we have now over 200 soul winners going out of the league. I think I have a small part of that, because I'm excited about seeing people get saved. And because of that, the teenagers are excited about people being saved. The adults are excited. Then all of a sudden, Benton Bell shows up for soul winning, and Hannah shows up for soul winning, and Brother Bell shows up for soul winning, and Mike Walker shows up for soul winning, and they're walking down the hallway, and they're saying, "Wow, oh, this is exciting. I'm going to go out soul winning today. I'm so excited. And will you be my partner?" And there's and that excitement spreads. I'm telling you, it spreads. You can have a soul winning church. You can have a soul winning environment. But it starts with you. It starts with you. You cannot give a soul winning illustration in your preaching if you did not have somebody saved.
There you go.
It starts with you. And as it starts with you, I promise you, usually, just like in a ball game, it spreads. It spreads. Just like in a ball game. People get excited about seeing somebody bounce a basketball down a basketball court. You get excited about seeing people saved, and all of a sudden somebody sits out there in the pew and they say, "Oh, I'd like to be a part of that. How do I get in?" And it spreads. But it starts with you. Can I ask you a question? I'm done. Here we go. You ready? When's the last time you showed somebody how to be saved? Can I ask you a question? When's the last time you gave somebody a gospel tract? When's the last time you did? I'm not talking about somebody getting saved in your ministry, under your preaching. I'm not talking about that. Forget all that. When's the last time you sat down with a sinner and introduced the sinner to the Savior? When's the last time you did that? When's the last time you witnessed? When's the last time you led somebody to Christ? God wants to use you. Father, help us, we pray. Help us to be the soul winners that we ought to be. Help us to be used, Father, please. Lord, we don't have to have a special education, a special degree. We don't have to have a great deal of knowledge. We just have to have a willing heart. Most of the people that sits in this room today knows more Bible than anybody else attending any other church anywhere in the world. But Father, help us to yield ourselves to you, to be soul winners. In Jesus' name, heads are bowed, eyes are closed, just one question. You say, "Pastor, I really want to be used of God to show somebody their need of Jesus Christ. I want to do a better job at being a soul winner. I want to do a better job at being a soul winner." And you say, "Pastor, will you pray for me? I want to do a better job at being a soul winner. Will you pray for me?" Here's my hand. Would you raise your hand, please? Would you raise your hand, please? God bless you. Father, you've seen the hands. Bless the preaching to come. We'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let's
hold the
please. Rescue the perishing. While we are singing, the academy students, please prepare on the second verse. Please line up here for this special number. We thank God that we have Pastor Ed Lorena there and other pastors who have just arrived. Thank you for being with us in this conference. Rescue the Poor Thing, 68. First verse, sing. Rescue the Perishing.